Shruti, my first question to you is, how did you prepare for the test and how long did it take?
Hi, sir. Good afternoon. Hi, everybody. I think I can see Rupa and Manika here. Hi, Rupa,
Yeah, hi Shruti. I'm excited to meet you. That too, I requested him to bring you for any one of the sessions before my exam. It's really good time to have a talk with you.
Thanks, Rupa. That's really sweet of you. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'll just
So,
take
in
1 minute.
response to sir's question,
Just 1 minute.
sure,
So
sir.
Shruti has Shruti, if you can tell us how much did you score in each of the sections? In listening, you scored 9. Oh no, not listening. In speaking, you scored 9. And probably of all the people whom I've trained, you are the one who scored 9 in speaking. Speaking is one particular section which seems to be the most difficult. Not difficult as such, but then it's a little mysterious sort of. It's more like an enigma. Nobody knows how a person scores high marks in speaking. Even people who come with excellent English speaking background end up at maybe 8 or 8.5. 9 is something like, some special thing, like the whole universe helping you on that particular day, that something happens and you score 9 bands there. So you can tell us how you prepared and how it has went that you scored 9 bands. And what about other sections? So in speaking, it was 9. In reading, it was.
Listening, it was 8.5, and in other two, writing and reading, it was 7.5, sir.
Okay. So one thing before you tell me, let me tell you, let tell a few things about her. So all the questions, like, book 8, test 1, test 2, test 3, and all of them, she took herself as her examiner, asked questions to her, got them recorded and sent to me. So it was not where I was waiting and asking her that I'm going to ask some questions to you and you are supposed to answer them. It was she who recorded and sent all those answers. So I think that is one thing which really worked wonders, because when you are motivated and when you do your own preparation, when you become your own teacher, the things go in a very different way. And same thing I think you did for writing as well. So one thing which is very, very clear and which is very distinct about her preparation was that I was more like helping her to know the nuances of writing and speaking. Just give me 1 minute, please. So it was my role was more towards correcting the content rather than directing her or telling her that you are supposed to do this, do that. All I did was that book 8 is there, do all the tests. Book 9 is there, do all the tests, and she did it. And so my task actually got very easy because I just had to check it. So I think this is one thing which is very, very important, that you take things in your own hands and you start driving stuff rather than depending on your mentor, trainer, whoever. So this is something which is which I learned from her, that how you take responsibility and start driving stuff. So that is something which is great. Yes, apart from that, Shruti, what else do you did? How you prepared from and how much time did you take? You can tell us.
I think first of all, sir is being very kind. I think he was always there. I mean, I probably bugged him for almost an entire month with sending him. I was solving questions every single day and I was sending him. I don't know how he got the time to look through all that. So I think it wouldn't have been possible if you would he wouldn't have not shown me the correct the route or the path, so to say. But in terms of preparation, I think really, guys, I think all of us are people who speak English or have studied in English. But what we don't realize is that the format is very different, and you need to familiarize yourself with the format. I think that's where the challenge is. So most of us, and I think I was also one of them who thought that I could just go without any preparation. And the first time around, that's what had happened as well. I did put in some preparation, but it was not the preparation that I took from the official books. And the second time, once I got in touch with sir, the entire preparation was only by the official books. So I actually, like sir said, I've solved book 7, book 8, and book 9, all the 4 tests. And what I did is that I spoke to sir and came up with a date based on, first I took a baseline test, and then with sir I consulted which date would be good enough for me to kind of apply, and so I blocked my test date, and then I worked backwards. So I made a target that I'm going to finish so many tests, or you know, this part of this test on this day. That's how I did. So it's not like I did one full test one day. I broke it down. So I broke down, I would at least finish 2 sections in a way, and I think roughly it was 2 weeks since the time sir and I had connected and we said that we'll go ahead with it. It was 2 weeks, but the entire thing was almost over a month. Because of COVID, I was not able to book a date in advance, but I think the solid preparation would be 2 weeks. And one other thing that I would like to tell all of you is take some time off work. Because most of us who are, I don't know if you all are working or not, but if you are working, then it becomes very difficult to juggle. At least, I mean, you know, take I would say 2-3 days before the test, I think you should take an off, because you really need to be in that zone. And I know that it's not possible to be in that zone if you're working, because somebody will ping you, and especially with work from home, you are available 24/7 to your office as well. So, you know, kind of cut that across and just apply leave for 2-3 days. And that's what I did as well. So I took the IELTS indicator because the test centers were not giving any tests. So that happens only every Wednesday. They only give out dates in India only on Wednesday. So because of that, what I did is that I took leave Saturday, Sundays, anyways, and off. And I took Monday and Tuesday as well and off. So I was in that zone for that entire week. That was one thing. And in terms of coming back to the preparation, I think, like I said, it was more about familiarizing yourself and understanding the tricks and trades. It's not about, okay, oh my God, how difficult English is. It's about how well do you understand the exam? And that's what I think I learned from sir as well. Like, say, for example, I used to not spend too much time looking at the questions earlier. That I learned from sir. So you need to invest time in looking at those questions, understanding what is the question. I mean, you know, like sir said, I mean, now I know what he says. He used to say the passage will speak to you. And I think towards the end of it, I realized that, you know, in the reading section, which is what I was quite afraid of, actually, I literally the passage started speaking to me towards the end of it once I started, you know, following his tips. So spend a lot of time on the questions. The other thing is generally, so I took the academic test. So generally it is understood
so we that can those take passages one section are... at a time. Let's do it like this, Shruti. So sure. You start with, let's say, reading. So
right. Yeah.
Specifically with regard to reading, you said the passage started speaking with you.
Yeah.
So what miracle happened that the passage started reading with you? How was it? How did you bribe the reading? Passage started speaking and yeah.
Yeah, 2 things there. So first is, see, the kind of reading material that is there in these sections, we are not used to reading that kind of material, especially with, you know, even I don't know if you all read newspapers or also not, but that is not the language that is available in the newspapers as well nowadays. So you are not exposed to that kind of very academic way of reading. Unless you're a student and you're still doing research, then maybe you will be exposed to that. So first is you have to expose yourself and read that kind of material every single day. And frankly, you don't need to read any other material if you just read these essays only. I mean, you know, if you read them again and again, your mind actually develops, like sir always says, you know, again, that was something that I saw, that it is your intuition that takes over your intellect. You understand, okay, this is how the passages are. It's hard to put in words, but it just happens. I mean, you know, you realize that, okay, this is this kind of a passage and probably this is how they will put in the questions. And when you're reading itself, you will realize, okay, something is in bold here or something is in italic here, something is a new word here. So I'm sure there'll be a question corresponding to that. So you tend to understand the pattern. So I think every single day, read the passage, do at least one reading section. That is what I would say. I used to do that. I did one reading section because it is only an hour, right? You have to time yourself as well. That is also very important. So I used to finish one reading section every single day and look at questions as well. I would read the whole passage. That I think I would say is more to individual comfort, whether you want to read the passage or not. If some people say that they don't need to read the passage. I found it comfortable to read the passage. So I used to read it. But that also, if you do it every single day, you pick up the speed as well. You can read faster. yeah. when you pick up every single day. So I think
so there is a pattern which means in reading what she's saying is that
yeah.
once you do like 10 tests, it becomes like a template in your mind. You know how the passage would unfold. The initial paragraphs are usually introduction, like true, false, not given has got a pattern. So you when your mind starts identifying them, it becomes very fast naturally. Rather than you thinking in terms of applying your intellect, it is more of your intuition which takes over and you gain speed is what happens.
Exactly.
Because you are, yeah, go ahead, please.
Yeah, no, and one other thing, sir, which really helped me was the corrections log. Hmm. So when you actually put down where you have gone wrong. So I used to maintain a Google Drive Excel sheet, which I had shared with sir. It was a Google Excel sheet where date-wise, so every sheet was a date-wise that I had taken the test. And I used to put down the explanation. For some questions, I wouldn't know where I went wrong. I mean, obviously, I mean, not all of us know why that question. Sometimes when you read the answer, you're like, why the hell is this the answer at all? You know, that thought also crosses your mind. So I would mark those down separately. If I have been able to understand where I went wrong, then I would put in the explanation. Otherwise, I would say needs discussion with sir. I would mark it for myself. And then when sir and I would connect, we would discuss it and he would tell me. And more often than not, it would be something which required probably closer reading. Or maybe something where there were these words like, I mean, you know, but, or however, more, which we miss, you know, when you're reading, you miss these words. The moment you see these kind of words and reading, the first thing is stop, slow down, read again. There is your answer. And also the other thing that really helped, sir, was when he divided the reading into two things. So in reading, he told me to look at the questions in two ways. One is find the where of the answer. Where is it in the passage? And then the what of it. So the what and where technique also that sir said. So when you read the question, you need to first, once you have, because you have read the passage already, you would kind of know that this will be in maybe paragraph 2 or paragraph 3. So first is locating that. And then it is reading those two lines only 2-3 times. Generally, what happens is that we again become a little conscious of time. That if I'm going to spend a minute on these 2-3 sentences, I will not get time. But I guess that is a wrong thing to do. I think let's just stick to those. Take a minute, read it, because it will help you and you will get the answer right as well. So read those 2-3 sentences again. So okay, I think so with regard to reading, I think these were the things, sir, really.
Yeah, that is correct. So reading, understanding where the answer is, then what the answer is. And also, you will find that most of the time the questions are in sequence. So you don't have to read the whole stuff. You can use combing, wherein you read one part of the paragraph and answer it, and then go to the second part and then go to the next part. So instead of reading the whole passage, you can go one paragraph at a time. And I think the key thing which is there with Shruti is that she actually did a lot of passages, because if you want to have some kind of pattern in your mind, you have to repeatedly do a number of passages before you identify the pattern and you see the kind of mistakes that you do. So that was about reading. And Shruti, one specific question is, did you also practice in the test environment while doing this practice? I mean, did you time yourself that you have to finish the whole test in 1 hour? You did those kind of iterations while doing practice?
Yes. So both things. One was because I was still not sure whether I'll be taking IELTS indicator or I'll be actually going to the test center. So I ensured that I have a quiet environment around me and I was not disturbed. That's why what I did is that instead of taking the full 3 hours, I used to break it down. So because it's easier to get 1 hour at home. I know the challenges of, you know, working from home and studying from home. So that's why what I would do is that I would break down the sections and take 1 hour. And I would time myself. I would time myself for the reading section and then take a break after the reading section.
Okay. So, yeah, you did time yourself. So this was about reading. Then let's talk about writing, which is, again, one section people are scared of because of whatever. You have got some question, Rupa?
Yeah, Rajiv. In reading itself, I have one question. How she managed to answer heading matching and other this kind of question, and especially MCQs.
Okay.
Okay. So with regard to the heading questions, that again, I think I took a tip from sir. What I did is that if it was, I always give a cursory glance to the questions first, just before going and reading the passage. And it was a heading matching question. What I would do is that I would read that particular paragraph. So if it's a paragraph A, finish reading that and then come back and see if I can answer any of the questions there and then go back to paragraph B. So you realize that when you start doing this once or twice, you realize that it's the same time that you will take, whether you read the full passage at a stretch or if you read one paragraph separately as well. But the plus point in that is you end up answering some questions as well. So you're actually indeed saving time when you do it that way. So that tip I got from sir again.
Yeah, true.
And MCQ was more, I think, in terms of, like I said, it's more intuition. I know I got a couple wrong when I was practicing and I would discuss with sir and I'd be like, sir, this doesn't make sense. Why have they chosen this? Why? I mean, you know, it really doesn't make sense. But I think you develop an intuition once you start doing these passages, because all the three books I finished twice. And that again is a great tip from sir, that do the same passage again and again. Because you will realize that if you give a 2 days gap, the questions that you have gotten right the first time, you'll get them wrong the second time. So it's got a lot to do with your state of mind as well. So yeah, Keep repeating that. I think these two will help you ready to come.
Okay, thank you.
I think the key thing is to do the same test again. Because again, when you do the same test the second time, you do it with a different mindset and a different perspective. You get to see, oh, this is also something, or this is also the perspective with which I can look at this question. And that
perfect mantra.
Perfect
mantra, doing same test again and again.
It's
learned it from sir only.
That do not do many tests, but do the same test many times.
You
know, you can always trick your mind by doing a little cheating. You know, that when you do the same test the second time, you already know the answers. So it's a very good feel good factor. Oh, I already know it. So something on which you struggled, now the question itself is telling you that, see, this is how I tricked you earlier. It's like you do the same test in your exam, like something which you did and the same question comes in your exam. So I think it's very important to condition your mind thinking that, oh, everything is so easy, because then it starts thinking it starts reacting in that way. So doing the same test again makes a lot of sense. So I always say, if you plan to do 10 tests before the exam, do not do 10 tests. Do 5 tests twice. You'll get more marks, you will gain more marks, and you'll learn more by doing 5 tests 2 times rather than 10 tests 1 time. So yeah, that is great, Shruti. Thank you for bringing that up. So this was all about reading. Any other question from reading before we move on to the next section, which is writing?
No, Rajiv, all good from my end.
Okay. So I have got one more question. Apart from this, Mahika, you have some questions? You were asking something?
No, sir. I was just saying all clear.
Okay. Were you into reading novels and stories and something of that sort? Did any kind of previous reading help?
I am somebody who reads a lot, but I'm never somebody who enjoyed academic reading, and that is what you have in this exam. So my previous reading has absolutely no, didn't really help me with this reading, because I purposely avoid academic reading when I'm reading for pleasure.
Okay. But then still...
Was it your second? Huh? Sorry. Go ahead. No. Was it her second attempt, as she mentioned?
It was a second attempt. Yeah, it was a second attempt. Okay. So the first time around, I got only a 6.5, and then I got in touch with sir, and then the next time I got a 7.5.
What about the speaking module in first attempt?
Yeah, so first, actually, you should be aware. So first, what happened is I was good with speaking the first time around as well. But this I had gone to the center. And this was when, I think, just before the second wave had started. So when I went to the center, they goofed up my recording, actually. So the first time when I gave, I was quite confident. And then because they didn't record, obviously, I got a little tensed. So that's why I got a 7.5 the second time when they asked me to go for it again. So, but had they taken my first recording, I'm sure I would have scored much better. I don't know what a 9, but of course, I think I would have scored at least 8 or an 8.5.
8.5.
Yeah, at least.
So in the first attempt, you scored 7.5 in speaking, was that so?
Yeah, yeah. I told you, sir, they had actually, their recording was not proper. They asked me to do it again. So in that exam scenario, you tend to get a little tensed when something like that happens.
Yeah.
So I'm sure that affected my score. Otherwise, because the first time around, the topic was also about books. So it was much easier for me to speak. And the second, this is in the first test only. When they didn't, when the recording didn't work, the second time it was something about clothes and other things. So already in my mind, I was a little, oh my God, the first recording didn't work well. So that was at the back of my mind.
So how do you take care of your anxiety? There is always this exam fear, whoever takes the exam. So how do you make sure that you are not afraid of the test and you take it in the right spirit?
In practice. That's the only thing that will help you with your anxiety. So whenever you're feeling anxious, pick up any section you like and just start doing. So I, for me, listening is my favorite section. I completely enjoy those conversations that they have and, you know, the way they are talking and all of that. So I somehow really picked up a very good liking towards listening. So when I would be anxious, I would just pick up for half an hour, pick up a listening and do a listening test. So I think practice is the only way that you can come out of this anxiety. There's no other way around.
Great.
So I want to ask something.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, Shruti. Actually, I have a question related to the listening, related to the speaking part. We tend to be very precise in our words, but in that case, we all at the same time, we try to be fluent by increasing the pace of our heard speaking. And sometimes on the flip side, this thing happens that you use simpler words, explain them very nicely, but then you tend to go off track. So how to manage that? Because when you get the topic on the spot, like an extempore, then you got to write some points beforehand.
Right. So two things here, Mahika. One is if you're talking about the second part, the part two, I assume that because of the extempore bit, I think you're asking about the part two, right? Where you can jot down points, etc.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what you do is that stick to the questions because they are only interested in understanding the question. So I think in one of Sir's videos, there was a strategy where he said, look at the question and just make one or two points with regard to that particular question. So if you are able to make one or two points for each question that is there in the cue card, you will have enough content to speak for a minute or two, right? The second thing is don't look at it as an extempore. Although it is an extempore, look at it as if it's a conversation. That is what helped me. And also probably the time that I got a 9, I think the topic was also very, it was quite easy to talk about because it was Bollywood and movies and Shah Rukh Khan. So it was very easy for me to talk about all of this as well. It was not something very intellectual or, you know, I'm not saying that Bollywood is not intellectual, but what I'm trying to say is that it was not something that required too much thought. It is something that we all know, right? We know movies. We talk about it with all of our friends. So two things you can do in terms of being a little less conscious about your speaking is A, what I did with Sir is, like he said, I used to record on WhatsApp and I used to send it to him. And B, ask somebody in your family or somebody to kind of just ask you the questions and respond to that. Get into that simulation mode so that, and do it again and again. Again, I mean, it might sound like I'm repeating, but record yourself and see how you have answered it differently. Because give it 2 or 3 days gap and you will notice that there is a change in the way you're talking. And most of these, I think you will also have, you can even check with Sir, and you can also go on some other websites and see how people have responded to these as well. Just look at one or two videos, how they're talking. So you will understand, okay, this is how they're being scored. But as long as you can keep it as a conversation, I think the score should be good in speaking. You will not have any problem in terms of that. It should be more in a conversational mode.
Okay. Thanks for explaining so well. But I just have a follow-up question to that.
Sure.
As you mentioned that we should treat it as a conversation, then does the vocabulary need to be profound or as we use in a way of talking?
It can be as you use in the way of talking.
Yeah, so don't make any special efforts to use some special word at that particular moment. If some word comes naturally to your mind, which is very profound, by all means use it. See, in speaking, yeah, the best part is there are no spelling mistakes in speaking. So even if you end up saying cornucopia of opportunities, you don't have to spell it. So you can take some liberty while speaking, you know. But then don't try to, and it's not that you will be evaluated separately on your vocabulary where you are using some heavy words, because the purpose of speaking is to check your day-to-day conversational skills. Even English, a native speaker would not speak Shakespearean phrases in their day-to-day conversations, right? So the purpose is to see whether you would be able to work in an environment where most of the people speak in English in a very day-to-day fashion. So
yeah,
you should not make an effort to use difficult words there. It's, if you look at the evaluation criteria, it's about fluency, context. It's about using appropriate words, not difficult words. So from that from the evaluation perspective, from the perspective of just presenting your ideas in an easy way, you don't need to worry about vocabulary.
Exactly. Okay, all right. I got the point. Thanks for explaining so well.
No problem. Don't try to force fit it. Just make it natural. If some word comes, because all of us have already a vocab, right? I mean, we know certain words, we use certain words. So just stick to that. That's it.
And as far as content is concerned, you can always lie a little bit, you know. There's no need to be absolutely honest in what you are speaking about. Like, one example a girl gave was that the question asked to her was, tell us about a book on history which you read, something about history. Do you like history or not? That was the question. And she said, yes, I like history. I'm a dentist and I like to read the books about dental history. So she she spoke about some historical development in the field of dentistry. So, you know, you can choose a topic in which you are so good that the other person knows nothing about. So, you know, you don't have to be absolutely, you don't have to give an anecdotal information, something which you experienced and saw. So if it is very commonsensical and if it makes sense in that conversation, you can always bring up that topic.
Yeah, just ensure that there are no breaks and you're not taking too much time to think while you're talking. Just, it has to be natural and it has to flow easily. And that will come when you have an exposure towards the kind of questions again.
All right. And just one more thing. Does the pronunciation matter, because our Indian English is a cocktail of British and American?
I would say as long as you don't have Madurang influence coming in, I think you're good. You can switch between. So, I mean, like I said, it should sound natural, even if we have, I understand where you're coming from. Like, say, do you need to say schedule or, you know, schedule, right? So that kind of a confusion. So I understand where you're coming from. But as long as you can be consistent and there is no Madurang influence, that is more important. So it should not be that you're using something which is generally not understood by the native speaker, you're good. So, like, I mean, you know, for example, if you're looking at, like, say, down south, generally people tend to say, instead of plan, they say plan. You know, it's not plan, it's plan, right? So something like those, they will pick up on those words. Or, like, say, for example, advertisement. There is advertisement and there is advertisement. So advertisement is something that's, unfortunately, in the subcontinent, we use that pronunciation, but that is not how it is generally pronounced. So as long as you're able to switch between the British and American, that's fine. Just ensure that no mothering influence creeps in, if there is any at all.
Like the Punjabi people say, my father sports me.
Yeah.
It looks like sports me. So, you know, my father supports me, should be supports me only. It should not be my father. I am also Punjabi and sometimes when I converse with my Punjabi friends and we pick up Punjabi English, it becomes you know, like Canada getting Punjabified. So yeah, I think that's what she's trying to say. Otherwise, English itself has so many dialects and so many different pronunciations that there is no one universal rule.
Exactly. As long as you use what is the pronunciation is something that you have used, which is generally and widely accepted, you're good.
All right.
You speak well, Mahika. As such, you know, your pronunciation is absolutely fantastic. You don't have to, you know, put a layer of some British or American accent over it. The way you naturally speak itself is perfect. You don't have to worry
about
it.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's a compliment. Thanks a lot. But, you know, in the back of my mind, I always try to segregate the pronunciation. Oh, it's American. And then it's British. So there I get a little tangled up.
Yeah, I know. I understand that. I mean, and I think most of us do that as well because we are so... See, I mean, as a nation, when we are taught in school, we are taught mostly the British pronunciation. But now, with so many of us watching so much on Netflix and other OTTs, we do pick up that American ring as well. So I totally understand where you're coming from. As long as you don't do too much of a mix and match, I think you're good. But even otherwise, they're okay with that. I don't think, like I said, as long as it's not something that they don't really know, they would not really cut your marks on that.
Let's All right. Writing now. So
yeah.
In writing, what I found initially was that Shruti used to write a lot. Like it was a long essay or a long graph. So if it was supposed to be 250 words, she would end up writing 450 words, you know, when you are in a flow. So she used to get into that flow of writing. So how did you manage that, Shruti? How did you cut it short from 450 to 250 afterwards?
That
too,
you
yeah.
Written 450 words in 1 hour.
Yeah, that means 1 hour. Sometimes 45 minutes, ta 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 ta, and 450 words, and so.
Yeah, well, I think that's a professional hazard, I would say, because I am into the communication space, so that's why I think it's easier for me to churn out words. So I would say that's an occupational hazard. But I think what really helped me is, again, when I sent my first few samples to Sir, he categorically told me not to go beyond the word limit. So for the 150 word essay, the graph essay, he said, don't go beyond 180, 190. And similarly for the 250 word essay, I think he said not beyond 290 or max 300. So then what happened is, instead of actually going ahead with two or three points and explaining, what I did is that I just explained and went back to my essay with just that one point. How can I refine that one point more? So I used my time more judiciously. Instead of writing longer answers, I used it towards refining. I think that's what I did. And it really helped that Sir said, don't go beyond that particular word limit. So, and like I said, it is not, again, a test of where, you know, they are testing your creative writing skills or, you know, how... what are the embellishments that you're using in the language? It's not a test of that. It's just a test of whether you will be able to, in the first instance, they're seeing if you have the ability to grasp, understand a pictorial graph, and are you able to represent that? And in the second one, will you be able to actually go ahead with simple writing in terms of having a structure to your writing? So that's again where I think Sir has a lot of material in terms of writing. So you can actually read through that, read it, and then write it in your own words. Again, I would say. And for writing, there is no other trick, but you have to write. If you're reading essays, that is not going to help you. You will have to write them. You will have to put that as a practice. Just by reading Sir's list, it's not going to help because those are not the questions that will come. You have to write, send it to Sir, and Sir is always very quick, actually. The moment you send him something on WhatsApp, I used to send it to him on WhatsApp once I was done writing. And Sir would come back and he would point out some sentences where, you know, another problem that I had was tense inconsistency. So that he kind of told me, he pointed out. And I never even realized that I had tense inconsistency in my writing before I took this course with Sir. So it always helps when somebody can look at it objectively and let you know. So, yeah, I think that's what I did.
Yeah, I think one thing, if I have to pick from this, is that you should first try copying the essays. That is absolutely fine. There's no harm in rewriting someone's model. Mm. But yes, writing is important. In order to improve writing, you have to write. It might be someone else's writing that you are just taking reference from and learning. Like we say, good artists copy and great artists
steal.
So you should not have any ego in stealing. As such, there is nothing original. Nobody came born with all the ideas. Everybody has stolen it from somewhere, right? So if someone, there's no copyright on ideas at least. Till the time somebody goes and does that. But yes.
Yeah. Also, another thing that actually, again, sir had told me was that, see, each essay, it's not like the examiner is going to sit there and say, wow, what great language, and, you know, going to spend some 50 minutes on it. They're only going to get, say, around 2 to 3 minutes on each essay, which is what sir had told me as well. So the idea is not to impress by your writing. That is not the idea here. It is just to let them know that, okay, this is the format, and I know the format, and I can articulate well. So again, if you see in sir's material, he tells you some phrases which can actually let an examiner know that, yeah, you know the format. Like, say, he would talk about to begin with, now let's delve into, to conclude. So, you know, there are these some catchphrases that he has mentioned. There are a lot of them in his reading material. So that what happens is that you don't waste time in thinking. Because once you start doing the writing as well, you realize that there are 4 or 5 types. And you know that where to use which kind of these phrases, which already sir has, which actually helps save time. Because then you can talk about what point that you're talking and kind of just quickly refine on that.
I'm thinking if Shruti starts taking IELTS classes, where will I go?
Ah, come on, sir. it's just what was there in your material that I'm just repeating now.
So I think, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And remembering all those phrases, and now you are so fluent on them that you are able to recall. Shows that you did all that practice and you consciously started using them. I think, yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
So let's come to, although writing was not something which I was thinking about, but then we recovered it. Let's talk about listening. How did you manage listening? Listening, as such, you said, was your favorite. So were there any challenges initially when you started, or it was more or less fine?
Not really. What I would say is that the easiest way to pick up on listening is watch some series on Netflix or some movies. Get yourself familized with the various accents that are there. That's the easiest way to do it. I mean, it's fun as well. And at the same time, it is a skill that you pick up also. Because, see, it's more about just having the ear to pick up those accents. And that's why you should expose yourself. So I think listening was the section that I took the least preparation for. I think the first time around when I took the test, it was a 9. Unfortunately, the second time it was 8.5. I don't know. I should have gotten a 9 the second time as well. But, I got an 8.5. So I would say the easiest way and the fun way to do it would be to watch some movies and watch across. Like, I mean, watch something which is British, watch something which is American, because they have a mix of accents. They also have some Australian accents as well in sometimes. And of course, I mean, you know, you can even listen. So what you should do, guys, is don't look at taking the entire test together in your preparation. Break it down. If you have a half an hour slot somewhere in between and you think that you have enough time, that 30 minutes, because generally the listening is only 30 minutes. Sit down at a quiet place, finish your listening test. Then again, if you have an hour in between, then again, you can do that. So this is, I'm talking about the initial phase of preparation. Then, of course, you can take a full test as well, because you will need to understand whether you're able to finish and take the test in the 3 hours. So listening, I would say, watch Netflix.
Great. I think the last question which I have is about the test day preparations. Did you do something special to keep yourself calm, and was there any special?
Actually, I wanted to come to this question. My exam is on July 10th, which is coming Saturday. So I want to understand how you prepared in your case and last minute preparation tips from you.
Okay, so all preparation stopped the day before night, for sure. And I think the last day, I didn't even do any tests. It was only corrections logs. So the correction logs that you that we have been maintaining. Am I audible?
Yeah, very much.
Okay, sorry. I was just getting a message that my network bandwidth is low. Anyway, so the corrections logs which were there, which I had been maintaining since the beginning of the preparation, I just went through those and just went to sleep early on, didn't you know, kind of stay late in the night to prepare and all of that, just slept. And in the morning also, I just looked through the corrections logs just once, because I was at home, I didn't need to travel, I was taking IELTS indicator, like I said. So I just looked through that once, and you know, just I mean, what I did was, because it was IELTS indicator, I spent more time in getting my system and the other settings. So they email you some settings based on what system you have. So I just went into that mode more to do. So no last minute preparation. I just shut my books after. So I think Wednesday was when I took my test. So I think Tuesday at around maybe 4-ish or something. After that, nothing. Just shut it and just be chill. Because I also had my speaking on Tuesday only. Tuesday at around 8 in the night was when my speaking was. So I just took a break.
All 4 on one day. Okay. So academic usually happens that.
Yeah, no, see, for academic, this special arrangement is there that you can take the exam from home. So she took the exam from home itself. On Tuesday, it was speaking, and Wednesday, it was all other sections.
Yeah, LRW on Wednesday.
Okay, I just want to ask one general question.
Yes.
Like you attempted the question paper from your home. And it sometimes happens that due to some reason or the other, you lose your bandwidth or you lose your connectivity. So do they show any considerations or you just lose what you lose?
So as per their website, they said that if you lose bandwidth, that is not an issue. You just need to have your internet connectivity stable at the beginning of a section and at the end of the section, so that you know your test can load and your responses can be the responses can get saved. But I had the same concerns, and I didn't want a network issue, so I used my hotspot. With the hotspot, it was okay. I didn't rely on my Wi-Fi. Although I have a good Wi-Fi, but I didn't rely on my Wi-Fi.
Oh, okay. Oh, that's interesting. I thought that this hotspot is less reliable.
Actually, yes, but because my Wi-Fi is connected to the electricity, so whenever the electricity goes, and if it takes around 2 to 5 minutes for the backup to come in, so the Wi-Fi also gets disconnected. So I was quite afraid of that. And that's why I decided to go ahead with the personal hotspot. So I took my entire 3 hours test on the personal hotspot.
All right. By the way, I'm also on hotspot today. And it's working fine, it seems.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think these are the questions. In case you have any other questions, you are most welcome to ask now. Otherwise, you can always ask, and I can ask Shruti to come once again, and we can have another round of questions for her.
So, how did you plan your writing? Like, as soon as you saw the topic, how you plan yourself to write about it?
So, I'm not somebody who generally takes notes when I'm writing. That's not generally how I write. So, the moment I would read, I would spend a minute or two on the question first. Just read, because what happens is that, I mean, you know, there are a lot of, it's very easy for us to go off topic from the question. That's how the questions are framed. I mean, you know, it's like almost they have something against us, but that's how the question is. So I used to spend a minute or two just understanding whether I've understood this correct. And then I would just form certain pros and cons, just have this thing ready, and then follow the format. So like, say, for example, you have, I think, 4 or 5, and that, again, you can get from source writing material, right? So immediately what you can do is that once you have recognized which type is it, immediately try and convert that into the format. And I would generally, I'm somebody who is able to write free flow. So I used to write free flow in terms of notes. So my thinking used to happen, the planning used to happen in terms of thinking.
Okay, that's cool.
Yeah. So ideally, after certain number of iterations, you intuitively start writing the moment you see the question. But then still, you should force yourself for at least 1 or 2 minutes to jot down the ideas so that you are at least organized and you identify the nature of the question. So initially, it makes all good sense to plan it. But then if you have, let's say, written 20 essays, which Shruti wrote before the exam, at least 20 essays and 20 graphs, after that, you kind of develop a structure in your mind. And if you have done it recently, it would be like you would be in that zone. So things will start flowing naturally because you do practice on a daily basis.
Yeah.
Right. So, still, like sir said, spending that 1 or 2 minutes just reading that question, because sometimes when you're giving these kind of exams, whether we like it or not, there is a certain amount of anxiety that is there. You are tensed. I mean, you want to first see, okay, what is the question? It's like it takes us back to the childhood, right? Achha, jo padha hai, wohi aa raha hai na? That kind of a thing. So just spend a minute or two, read it again, and then you can get into that, get into answering the question.
One more query on that. Always, we tend to have many points for the same essay. And there, if we just pick one point to write our essay on, then we tend to rephrase the same words again and again on a loop. So do you write one point, pick up one point and write the essay on that? Or you make a collection of many thoughts and put them all on the paper?
This was actually something that I personally went through as well. So like you said, I am also somebody who would want to kind of put in 2 or 3 points for that, right? I mean, that's the general tendency that we have. But believe me, IELTS is all about paraphrasing. They are only looking at how well are you able to paraphrase in your writing, in your speaking, especially in these two, they're just looking at that. So I would rather say stick to 1 point. So if say it is an advantage, disadvantage question, just stick to 1 point, but instead give an example to substantiate your point. So that is what I did. So if it was this kind of a question, generally that's how it is, right? It will be 2 viewpoints that are there. Most types will have 2 viewpoints. Either you have to agree or disagree, or you have to state your opinion. So when you're breaking it down into the paragraph, don't go beyond 4 paragraphs. First is your intro. Second is your first main point and second main point, or it would be your advantage point and disadvantage point and conclusion. So instead of putting in another point, I would say put an example to substantiate that point.
Yeah. So.
All right. And do you write an active or passive speech?
Frankly, I think that is also something that I think sir had corrected quite a bit in my writing as well. Didn't really pay too much attention there, Mahika. I think it was more a natural flow. But I think sir would be able to answer that better, whether there is a particular.
Yeah. So you don't have to worry about it. And. All that matters is the examples and the content you write is relatable. Whether you give your personal anecdote or you take some third person's example, whatever you are talking about should be something which is very generic in nature. Like, for example, I went for bungee jumping and deep sea diving. So everybody might not have gone there. So if I try to give such kind of examples, probably everybody would not be able to relate to it. But if I talk about something which is very relatable, like a train journey or going by bus, you would understand, oh, okay, fine. That's what he's talking about. So give examples which are very generic in nature. Active voice, passive voice really does not matter. What matters is that you write in a very simple manner and you do not go off topic.
All right, I got your point. Well, I asked that question because personally, I feel like, as sir knows, I write poetry. So I tend to go in a passive tone always, right? Whether writing an essay or a poem or anything.
I get you, Mahika, because like I said, it's an occupational hazard with me as well in terms of just a free flow writer. So I get where you're coming from. But like sir said, it will even take you a little time. You will also feel that this is the worst piece you have ever written when you start writing in simpler terms. Believe me, I've been there, you know. It feels like this is not how I write usually. I mean, you know, I write much better. But like I said, the idea is more to kind of, it's not a creative writing course, or it is not something where, you know, you're trying to impress them with the vocab that you have or the language skills that you have. They are looking at how simply can you get the point across through your writing. So
be a Milkha Singh of writing to win this.
Yeah.
Right? In a race, there would be only one Milkha Singh who wins, you know, flying Jat. So you need not be a flying writer to get those 9 bands in writing. And like, if there are 4 people and if all of them are able to meet the standards, all of them will get 9 bands. In a race, it rarely happens that 4 guys won the race. You have to be the fastest and the best. But here, you don't have to be the fastest and the best. it's like a standardization test. So it's a standardized test, I mean to say. If you meet the standards, you would get it. Like, you know, if five people go for COVID test, it's not that the fittest guy would only be declared as COVID negative. If all of them don't have COVID, they would be, okay, fine, you go and enjoy. It's like that. So IELTS is like a COVID test where all of them can be COVID negative.
Mahika, one question though. Are you a lit graduate or are you studying literature?
I'm actually a school-going girl, 11th grade. Yeah.
Okay.
But she is very much in literature. You caught her.
Yeah, exactly. Because the questions that she's asking seems like she might be interested in studying English literature or something like that. I don't know if that's true. But
actually, it is true because I'm publishing my book right now for poetry. Wow. So it's like I am a little interested in that, you can say.
Right. So then this one is for you, Mahika, for sure. Don't look at this as a way of impressing them. I mean, this exam is just, I don't know why you're taking it, but this is just to meet the standard. So don't look at this as a means of trying to impress anybody with your writing skills. That is not what this exam is for. Because I went through the same thing. Like Sir was saying, right? I used to write long essays. I used to be a natural writer. So I had to really bring in a lot of change in my writing for this. So don't get into that. And also one more thing, say, once you have given the test, like say, for example, I myself, when I saw that I got a 7.5, in fact, Sir and I also discussed, we were thinking that maybe I would get an 8. That's where we were thinking as well. And don't get disheartened, because again, it is not a measure of your creative writing. It is just, like Sir said, it is about standardizing your writing. So even if, say, I'm not saying that you will not get 8, you might very well, and that will be great. But if at all that doesn't happen, don't think of this as a personal failure or, you know, oh my God, my writing is not good. Don't go into that zone, because that's not the case. Your writing, your creative writing or the writing for literature or how you want to study ahead is going to be very different from what you are expected to do here. This is just something that you need to do for this exam. So tone down, that's what I would say.
Yeah, I understand the point. I am very, you know, calm in that. I don't take it too hard, very easily.
Yeah, good. That's good. That's good.
Raju, one kind request. Is it possible to share some writing which was written by Shruti?
How many? 20? How many you want? Tell me.
No, here, all it's up to you. Share some sample. Is it what
she sent so many. And you know what? It was not just one. So when I used to tell her that these are five corrections, there was version one, there was version two, there was version three. So she made all those iterations, writing them and correcting it. This is the next one. This is the, so you can, I'll definitely send them. So this is something which is, you know, see, irrespective of how good or bad you are at English, when there is a standardized test, you have to go through that rigor of preparing for it, you know. Like, for example, if you might be a pilot, but then if you want to ride your kid's bicycle, you will have to do some practice. It doesn't matter whether you are a pilot or what. She did that. So she was a pilot of writing, you know, working in company where conversing with all the people. So see, she went through that rigor, which is something so very important. So I'll definitely share it. I'll, in fact, share some versions of her, that this is the first one, second one.
That will be really helpful. And it is very fortunate that I got a chance to meet her just before my exam. And thanks, Rajiv, for bringing her. And Shruti, for you also, it's a pleasure. Thanks to you for joining.
No worries at all. Yeah. Not at all. I mean, please, I mean, it's the least that I can do. And especially the great help that Sir has been to me. It's just, this is nothing, literally.
So thank you so much, Shruti. It was really a pleasure having you once again and having this conversation after like almost a month's time. Wish you all the very best, and we'll keep bothering you with all the questions in future also.
No worries at all, sir. Always happy to have a chat with you and any of your students.
Thank you.
I really appreciate the idea of having a mentor and a like participant here, discussing the questions with us, because we have no clue how we are going to sit there. Rajiv sir is preparing me, but still I'm a little, you know, under preparation for that. I have to work on that. So thanks a lot.
No worries. Just keep practicing, guys. I think that's the best way, and keep connecting with Sir. Have a schedule planned out with him. So that what you do is that, to make best use of Sir's time, you finish a lot of work beforehand, so that, I mean, you know, you can get more guidance from sir in that regard.
Yeah, I think that's a very valuable advice. Okay, so thank you so much, Shruti, and thank you all of you, and keep practicing, keep sending all your answers. I would love to see how you write and how you improve from here, and I'll definitely share Shruti's work with you, and we'll take it forward from there. Have a lovely weekend. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.